fortunate to have Bruce back, and he came to America because Bruce is a real interesting character. Number one, he started out in the Bronx, and he was not a religious person. He wasn't even a Jew. And, I mean, he was born a Jew, but he wasn't a Jewish by faith. And as he grew up, he discovered things that he was being called back to the land of Israel. He discovered in his heart that this is where he was supposed to go. Not even knowing much about it, because his mom and dad weren't necessarily into all of the things of the Jewish faith. He found it because Yah wanted him to. So it's really an exciting thing to see this guy. I met him in Jerusalem in 1999. And I was with, actually Michael Rood had met him first, and then I went over and Michael and I met him. And this guy has been a joy in my life ever since I met him. He has a windmill on the top of his house. I mean, it's a turbine in Tekoa, which is an isolated community up on a hill in the middle of the Judean hill, where it turns, a windmill that turns it. In that windmill, where it goes open, he stands and looks for the new moon. And he's been doing that for probably 15, 20, maybe 30 years now. He looks for the new moon. And that's how Michael and him connected, because he had been looking for the new moon. There's many, many stories, we can go on and on, but the biggest thing about Bruce is that he's not only coming out to see you and help you get an idea and a comfort that these people love you, and he wants you to come home if that's where you belong. He isn't trying to keep you out. And I think that's a real privilege to have a guy that's fighting for us from inside the land. Bruce Brill is. Amen.
Now, Bruce is a musician. He plays a unique instrument. In the South, it's kind of akin to David's harp. Okay? It's called, he plays a unique type of music called Jewgrass. So I'm going to ask Bruce to come. Give him a hand, please.
Can you hear me?
Yes,
okay, good. Thank you so much, David. What a privilege and a pleasure and an honor to be here, and I hope my throat clears up so I won't have you suffer a raspy voice. But I was going to start by saying that a little bit about me, so that you know who's standing before you, besides all the accolades that were just showered on me, and I got my applause already, I can leave now. But I grew up as a secular Jew, and I was going to say born out west, but Jamie blew it, and then the question would be, where out west? And the answer is the West Bronx. And so, yes, I'm a Yankee. The home of the Yankees is the Bronx, thank you. Miracles happen. And I think one of the biggest miracles, and I'll talk about two miracles. One of the biggest miracles is that the Jews, after the Great Dispersion, in 135, most people say 70, the common era, the year 70 after the Second Temple was destroyed by the Romans, and many Jews were taken into captivity and forced emigration from the land. But there were still Jews in the land, even as late as 135, when the Bar Kokhba revolt against the Romans happened. And so there were enough Jews in the land of what the Romans renamed Palestina. And the term Palestine comes from the Latin term Palestina, which is a throwback to the hated enemies of the Jews that David fought in his day, the Philistines. So Palestina comes from the term Philistine. And so that's why the Romans renamed Judea Philistine. You probably know this. But if you read the media, you see that Israel is often referred to today wrongly as Palestine, and that there is a people known as the Palestinian people. You know, Mark Twain said, if you don't read the newspaper, you're uninformed, and if you do read the newspaper, you're misinformed. And that happens today big time, big time. Because we see time and time again this creation, and I'm not going to get too deeply into American politics, but Newt Gingrich said that the Palestinians are a created people. He was the only candidate for president in a previous presidential race that is a historian, and he happens to be correct. There was no such thing as a Palestinian people ever. And in 1964, the PLO was founded. PLO, Palestine Liberation Organization. In 1964, was there what the media calls an occupied West Bank? No, there wasn't, because it was under Jordanian administration. So what does that mean in 1964 when the PLO was formed? With the purpose of liberating Palestine. They weren't intending to liberate Judea and Samaria, the West Bank, nor Gaza. That was under Egyptian administration. So what was the PLO intending to liberate in 1964, before the Six-Day War? They wanted to liberate Israel from the Jews. But we forget this. We forget this, but it's ABCs of Middle Eastern history. So a little bit about me. As Jamie indicated, I grew up as a secular Jew. And this is very typical of American Jews, that we don't have any Jewish background, and we don't have any Jewish fervor, and we certainly don't have any Jewish education. Very minimal. I went through what I refer to as the bar mitzvah factory, that a young man goes to learn the letters, the 22 letters. It's not an insurmountable task. And the vowels that go around those letters, so that you can read enough of the prayers on your bar mitzvah day to perform. And it's a performance, and that's all it is. Otherwise, it's practically empty. It's void of content. And I'm assuming that most of you are returning to Hebrew roots to learn what Jesus' Bible said. You don't call him Jesus, you call him Yeshua. What Yeshua's Bible said. And I today try and live my life according to Yeshua's Bible, which was the Hebrew Scriptures. And in order to understand the Hebrew Scriptures, you have to know Hebrew. And that's not what a typical American Jew is prepared to do. So it's miraculous, miraculous, that if most Jews were like me with my empty background, that the Jewish people survived from the time of the dispersion. We're talking about going on to 2,000 years. 2,000 years of Jews scattered far and wide, being hounded and hampered and expelled and persecuted and suffering pogroms and suffering inquisitions. And finally, the irony of all ironies, suffering a Holocaust where a third of our people were eliminated, were exterminated, a third of our people. Yet at that moment, Israel came into rebirth. Is that not miraculous?
Yes.
That's the first miracle. The second miracle that's adjacent to that one, attached to it, is one that's unfathomable. All this was prophesied by the Jewish prophets, and it's all in the Hebrew scriptures. Not only is this impossible, historically unprecedented thing to occur, but it was predicted that it was going to occur. So it's amazing. And another prophecy that was predicted is that in the end of days, the house of Judah, the Jews, and the house of Israel, Ephraim, were going to unite. So we know where the Jews are, the house of Judah, but where's the house of Israel? Either the prophets were smoking something that's legal in Oregon today, or they were liars, or it's happening. And I am so privileged to be here today to see you people in action. It's something that has to be brought home. And home for me today is Israel. I've been living in Israel now, this year, for most of my life. I'm 68, and 35 of those 68 years, almost 69, 35 of them have been in Israel. Yeah, that does deserve applause. That does deserve applause. If I were going to tell you it's a piece of cake, I'd be lying. It's not America. We met some Israelis a few weeks ago that were new to America, and we were having a Shabbat dinner with them. And we asked these young Israelis, what's your impression of America? And the one word that came first out of their mouths was Shefa. Shefa means abundance. It's something that Americans don't appreciate. You folks don't know what you have until you live outside America. And not only an abundance of material goods, but an abundance of freedom. I'm telling you, even in Israel, which is always celebrated as the only democracy in the Middle East, we still don't have the freedom that you people enjoy. And you don't know how good you got it. You don't know how good you got it. Appreciate the country that's yours. It's a God-blessed country. And I think one of the reasons that it's God-blessed country is that America has supported Israel for her 68 years.
To lose it next election.
See again?
We're about to lose our freedom next election.
I'm going to play you a song. Participation, congregant participation. So I'd like you to help me with this song too. I want to teach you a few Hebrew words. You know, very often in English translations of scripture, you hear God referred to as Lord of the Hosts. The word hosts is, in Hebrew, is the word Tzvaot. Can you say that? Tzvaot? Tzvaot. Okay, that's one of the words that you need to know. Really what it means in modern Hebrew, or in common Hebrew today, spoken Hebrew, is armies. Tzava is army, and Tzvaot are armies. So, hosts. Doesn't mean that God is going to be hosting you, but maybe it does in a way. Another word, asher. Asher, that's a very common word you see all over in modern Hebrew and biblical Hebrew, which is basically the same, by the way. You know, Hebrew, that's another unprecedented, historically unprecedented phenomenon, that a language that was dead as a spoken language, dead as a spoken language, not as a written language, as a spoken language, was revived. Where else have you seen something like that? It's never happened. The Irish, that spoke Irish Gaelic, tried to revive their language rather than speak the language of the hated British. But they didn't succeed, did they? But the Jews succeeded. Unprecedented. So, asher, that, or which. Okay. Lay more means saying. It's actually the infinitive to say, but in this case it would be translated saying. Lay more? Lay more. Okay. So you'll see where you have to say this. We've heard that Imachem, Jew and Ephraim marching arm in arm to Jerusalem. You heard me say God, and you heard me say Yah in the translation. So, Yah is one of the names of God, kind of like an informal name of the ineffable name, the Tetragrammaton. Jews don't try to pronounce the ineffable name. Well, Orthodox Jews don't. In fact, there's a prohibition against trying to even pronounce it. The prohibition is so stringent that an Orthodox Jew will tell you anyone who tries to pronounce the Creator's ineffable name will not have a place in the afterlife. It's that strong a prohibition. And so, we've forgotten how to pronounce God's name. Of course, if you read scripture, and I know you all do, you know that time and time again it says, if you will call on my name, you will be blessed.
Amen.
So how does that jive with the Orthodox Jewish understanding? You'll have to ask an Orthodox rabbi, because I do try and understand how God's name is to be pronounced so that we can call on his name.
Hallelujah.
And be blessed.
Yeah.
There are certain hints in Hebrew names. You've heard of Yehonatan, Jonathan, Yehonatan. Yeho, the prefix, is part of God's name. There are other names with suffixes that have part of God's name. And here's another Hebrew lesson. In scripture, you'll find these characters, Benaya. In Hebrew, that's Benayahu. Ezekiel. Am I saying you? No, Elijah. Elijah is Eliyahu. Isaiah is Yishayahu. Jeremiah, Yirmiyahu, Hezekiah, Chezkiyahu, Mattathias, Matityahu. You notice that they all have something in common.
Yes, sir.
The suffix is part of God's name, which inspired me to song. And I love playing this for Westerners, because the song is written in a language that you understand, cowboyese. Yeho Yahoo, yippee yippee Yahoo, Yeho Yahoo. Take Yehonatan at the time of David, and Yehoyadahu had a son. In the book of books is Yahoo number one. Since he's first, let's put him in the verse. Who was he? Great Yahoo. Benayahu, yippee yippee Yahoo, Benayahu. Eliyahu, thought the chuck had ceased, made days of feast. I guess a culture barbecue. It was Eliyahu, Yippee-yahu, Eliyahu. He loaned face down 200, 450, way up there on Mount Carmel. For heaven's sake, he gave him hell. What a thrill like Pecos Bill, whisked away when the whirlwind blew. Eliyahu, Yippee-yahu, Eliyahu. Well, he had savvy as Moe's dear Abby. He shot straight and true. He was Hestiyahu, Yippee-yahu, Hestiyahu. On false gods he frowned at my Spotsy down with her totems of wood and blue. Hestiyahu, Yippee-yahu, Hestiyahu. Sinatra's Assyrian scorned him, said they'd knock him out with a 1-2 blow. But he sidestepped them with the do-si-do. Got sick to death, got a second breath, built him more waves and pools. He was Hestiyahu, Yippee-yahu, Hestiyahu. He was Yishayahu, Yippee-yahu, Yishayahu. Head hired hand of King Yotham, Ahaz and Hestiyahu. He was Yishayahu, Yippee-yahu, Yishayahu. From futures he made himself a prophet. Get the joke? Saving the part of the pun. His kinsmen then and now, with the chief of chiefs, he'd powwow. That son of a gun, Hestiyahu, son, cut our boy in two. Poor Yishayahu, Yippee-yahu, Yishayahu. With Baruch he'd ride, his sidekick and scribe, his paw was Hilkiyahu. He was Yirmiyahu, Yippee-yahu, Yirmiyahu. Trod the trail of tears for many years, consoling his fellow Jew. Yirmiyahu, Yippee-yahu, Yirmiyahu. Said any strain could have the brand of A-OK through the reins of Yehoahim. Said Akiah, Hosea, Yehoahim. Said you got no to make friend or foe, but he couldn't get the message through. He was Yirmiyahu, Yippee-yahu, Yirmiyahu. First Maccabean from Modi'in, a priest with a 5-son brood. Matityahu, Yippee-yahu, Matityahu. His heart was aching when told to eat bacon. Slice that Syrian swine in two. Matityahu, Yippee-yahu, Matityahu. On false gods he frowned. No, I did that one. Matityahu. Matityahu's Maccabean minute man. Simon, Judah, Yohanan, Elazar, and Yonatan. One against Ariad with soul like Rashad, these stout-hearted few. And Matityahu, Yippee-yahu, Matityahu. A geography lesson. How many Israels can fit into the state of Oregon? Anyone have an idea? The people who know, don't say you're not part of the contest. You have a guess? Anybody have a guess? 4? 12. A dozen, a full dozen. Israel's can fit into the state of Oregon. How many Israel's can fit into the state of Texas? You're sitting down, right? 33. 33. You know, the Texans pride themselves on being the biggest state in the contiguous, now you have to add the adjective contiguous United States. I remember when Alaska and Hawaii weren't states, and when they became states, there was this one Texan talking to an Alaskan. He said, I don't like the idea that you're being admitted into the Union. Now you're going to be the biggest state. I think they should cut Alaska in half. So the Alaskan says, you don't want to be the second biggest state. You want to be the third biggest state. How many Israels can fit into Alaska? It's got to be bigger than 33 times 2, right? 83. So, and that's by way of introducing the last verse of this song. And another item that I have to add is the thing that inspired this song. There are many different kinds of Jews. And when we moved to Tekoa, when we were first accepted, actually, in 1978, there were 7 families in Tekoa. Tekoa, the hometown of the prophet Amos. Today there are 3 Tekoas. There's Jewish Tekoa, there's Arab Tekoa, and there's the ruins of ancient Tekoa, the hometown of the prophet Amos, and the hometown of King David's right-hand man, General Ira. And the hometown of someone whose name we don't know, but she's known as the wise woman of Tekoa. So these biblical personalities were natives of ancient Tekoa, and the ruins of ancient Tekoa are there, and they haven't been excavated. Unfortunately, they've been put into Area A, which is under Palestinian Arab authority. So, we were family number 8. Today, there are over 800 Jewish families in Jewish Tekoa. And it's a miracle to me. I see prophecy being fulfilled before my very eyes. Every morning that I might go to do guard duty, because it's a requirement that any local Arab that comes in to work in Jewish Tekoa has to be escorted by an Israeli, an armed Israeli. And sometimes that armed Israeli could even be an Arab who's guarding Arab workers. So, things that you don't read about in the newspaper. But when I see this every morning, I see several hundred Jewish men leaving Jewish Tekoa to go to work in Jerusalem or wherever, and several hundred Arab men coming in. It's like a population transfer. Coming in for the day to build Jewish homes and Jewish institutions, kindergartens and schools and roads and infrastructure. And it's something that was foreshadowed in Scripture, where you will go in to possess the land, and in fact this week's Torah portion is recounting that, when you go in to replace a people that are bigger than you and stronger than you and mightier than you, and you will dwell in homes that you did not build. Kind of a little foreshadowing there, because that's what's happening today.
Yes, sir.
One of the residents of Tekoa was a guy named Bob, who is a Rambo. Every community has their resident Rambo. And Bob had tattoos on his forearm, something that's forbidden by Orthodox Jewish law, but he had them anyway. And he had a tough guy way of talking, with a New York tough guy accent, you know, like a James Cagney type accent. I'll get you like you got my brother. So back in 1996, I'm dating the song, there were elections. And just like here in America, the media in Israel is very, very left-leaning. And the day of the election, when it seemed like they were neck and neck, this is the only time in Israel's history that individuals ran for the prime minister's office. And then it was Netanyahu running against Shimon Peres. And the media announced at the end of the day that it looks like Shimon Peres is the winner and he will be the prime minister of Israel. But in the morning, all of us went to bed sad, but in the morning, I went to visit Rambo Bob, and I said, Bob, what do you think? Because the election, the votes came in from the soldiers and from remote villages, and they swung the election in favor of Netanyahu, and Netanyahu won. So I said, Bob, what do you think? And he says, Bruce, I want to tell you something. The skies are blue. And I thought that was so poetic that I wrote this song, and you can hear the skies are blue in the last verse. They chose to choose the Netanyahu's Yippee-yahoo, Netanyahu. On July 4th day, got blown away. No, how does it go? Oh, I forget the words of my own song. This is not supposed to happen. Let me start the verse again, maybe it'll flow. Okay. July 4th day got killed in the bold rescue. Yoni Netanyahu, Yippee-yahoo, Netanyahu. Dark clouds fell over the sky of half the nation. But on the morrow of election day, got totally blown away. Now to many of you heard the skies seem blue, the great spirits here gave proof. He used Netanyahu, Yippee-yahoo, Netanyahu. Now to many of you heard the skies seem bluer, the great spirits here and gave proof. He used Netanyahu, Yippee-yahoo, Netanyahu. Sailed the ocean blue, and it's like a day that's celebrated in American history, but it wasn't a day that was celebrated by the Jews of Spain, because that's when Ferdinand and Isabel issued an edict expelling all Jews from Spain, to be followed soon after in Portugal by a similar edict. So the Iberian Peninsula would be freed of Jews, another expulsion. However, if Jews converted to Catholicism, they would not have to leave. And many Jews chose to convert, at least overtly, on the surface. They converted and they preserved their Jewishness secretly. and they were called conversos. And many of them used that interim period to flee the Iberian Peninsula. Many came to the New World. Many settled in Mexico. But the tentacles of the Inquisition and the Catholic pursuing the Jews followed them into the New World. And many of these Jews fled the population centers and went off to remote areas in Mexico. And they began an agricultural practice that was unknown to Europeans, but known to Hebrews, and is written in the rabbinic literature. The practice of free-ranging livestock. And this is what they began doing in northern Mexico, which eventually evolved into the institution of the cowboy. And the institution of the cowboy, therefore, has its origins in these Sephardic, Spanish, Jews that were fleeing the Catholic Church. Interesting, huh? And there are some indications of that in folk music. One of the most popular songs in the American West is She'll Be Coming Round the Mountain. Have you ever thought about She'll Be Coming Round the Mountain? The song really doesn't make any sense unless a Jew wrote it and was thinking about the Sabbath Queen. Think about it. She'll be coming around the mountain. The song never says who. And why we all go out to greet her. And why she's riding six horses. What, one horse is enough, or two, or four? Why six? And why all of a sudden we're eating chicken and dumplings? And if we're eating chicken and dumplings, then why the need to kill the old red rooster? The song doesn't make sense. Unless a Jew wrote it, he was thinking about the Sabbath Queen. Because this is a traditional Jewish practice to go out and greet the Sabbath. The Sabbath Queen, she's known as the Sabbath Queen. Jews sing a song called Lechod Odi, that's the welcoming the Sabbath song in synagogue. And at the last verse, this is when the Sabbath Queen enters. And all the congregants turn around and face the entrance and exit door, welcoming the Sabbath Queen. And the traditional Jewish meal for the Sabbath is chicken, because it's a meat that can be eaten cold. Uh-oh, but what about the rooster? Before there were alarm clocks, what would get you up to go to work in the morning? The rooster, one day a week. Kill that old red rooster.
We'll all eat chicken and dumplings when she comes. We'll
Does their glory exceed that of ours? What a question. What a question to look up in the heavens and ask rhetorically, or ask of the Creator, does man's glory compare to that of the universe that you created, represented by the moon and the stars in heaven? But the question is not answered. There was another singer-songwriter who predated the author of Home on the Range who asked the same exact question. And that singer-songwriter was someone you may have heard of, King David. The difference is that King David answers the question in Psalm number 8.
Yeah.
little biblical commentary on this. I'm not a theologian. I'm not a Bible scholar. I'm not even a very good Bible student. But the last verse was, a little less than God, you created man. You heard that verse. If you open a Jewish Bible, you'll see that it says, a little less than the angels, you created man. Whereas if you open a Christian Bible, it says, a little less than God, you created man. And I use what seems to be the Christian translation. Me, a Jew. Well, I have it on good authority from Rabbi Meir Kahana. I don't know how many of you have heard of Rabbi Meir Kahana, but he was assassinated. He was an American Jew, Orthodox rabbi. He wrote a half a dozen books, theological books. And then he immigrated to Israel and he began a political party called Kach. And he got one seat 1 year, and the establishment in Israel didn't care for him very much. So they got together, both the left and the right, the Likud and the Labor, they got together and they made his party illegal. And this was just prior to an election where all surveys were indicating that he was going to get at least 10 seats in the Knesset for his party, and maybe up to 12 or 13. And they made him and his party illegal. Rabbi Kahana speaks about this question, about the translation of the word Elohim in this verse. And you can check it out in Psalm 8. Me'at me'Elohim, a little less than Elohim. And some of you know some Hebrew, and you know that Elohim, 99% of the time, is translated God. And we have no indication of, is this used singular or plural? Whether it could be angels or whether it could be God. It's not clear. So it's understood from context. And the Jewish translation, they say angels. And the Christian, as I said, say God. But Rabbi Meir Kahana said, man on the stepladder of the divine is higher than the angels. So it's impossible for man to be lower than the angels. So it can't be man is a little less than the angels. Because Meir Kahana said that the Christian translation in this instance is correct. And I won't go into the theological reasoning, but you can Google him, Rabbi Meir Kahana. And it's sad what happened to him. I know this is Saturday and it's the Sabbath, but you have to pat prophets of their day on the back, and he was prophetic. And just like the prophets of old, he was eliminated, and so were many of his followers that were either eliminated, or even his son and his daughter-in-law were killed in what seems to be targeted execution. And some of his followers, even his bodyguard, a personal friend of mine, is sitting in an American jail. And while I'm mentioning that, I have to mention his wife, because we all watch movies and read books and we see on the big screen stories about heroes and heroines. But how many of us have ever really met a hero in the flesh? Bob and his wife were put in jail for what I believe was a frame-up in order to get him extradited to the United States. And the man who investigated this was one of the pioneers of the Ephraimite movement, a man named Del Griffin. If you haven't heard of him, you should check him out, because he was one of the pioneers of the Ephraimite movement. Today he's known as Magid Ben Yosef. Maybe you've heard of him under that name, Magid Ben Yosef. He's working today on understanding that the American Indians, or many among the American Indians, are part of the Ten Lost Tribes, are Ephraimites. And he was the one who began the whole Josephite movement. You've heard of Joes and Jews? Joe meet Jew, right? This was begun by Del Griffin. So Del Griffin investigated the story behind the Mannings, Robert and Rochelle Manning. And this frame-up put them in an Israeli prison in Ramla. And I was asked to visit them once a week with their then 8-year-old daughter, Moriah. You've heard the wind called Moriah, the spirit of Moriah. And I would visit them. Bob was extradited, and Rochelle's extradition was pending appeal after appeal, and all of them failed, and she was to be extradited in a few days. She understood that any Jewish community that turns over a Jewess for capital punishment to Gentile authorities, that Jewish community would receive divine punishment. She believed that. And she didn't want Israel to suffer divine punishment. Did I ever tell you this story? I did. She took her own life rather than be extradited and see Israel suffer divine punishment. Is there anything more heroic than that? An Orthodox Jewess knowing that to commit suicide is against Jewish law, and that you're risking your soul, your very soul, from the world to come, eternal life. Yet she chose that path rather than see Israel suffer divine punishment. Amazing. Amazing. I'm awed and humbled by that. So that's a little side story about the times we're living in, and the kind of experiences that we see happening in Israel. So Robert is still sitting in an American penitentiary in Phoenix, Arizona. We tried to visit him when we traveled to Phoenix, but it didn't happen. And you can't call in to speak to Bob Manning. His name in Hebrew is Reuven, which is one of the Ten Lost Tribes, as you know. But he could call out, and he did. And this was a miracle. My phone worked at that time. That was a miracle. And he called us, and we spent a quarter of an hour speaking with him. That's the time that's allotted. His dream is to sit out the rest of his term in jail in Israel. That's his dream. And what else can I tell you? I think there's another song or two that's on the list. Can you remind me? I think that would be a good one to end. I've got enough songs to keep you here until the end of Sabbath, but I think He Made My Toad might be a good one. And that's another Jewish cowboy connection, because what's the melody? Hinei matov manaim shevet achim gam yachad. Hinei matov manaim shevet achim gam yachad. Everybody. Hinei matov manaim shevet achim gam yachad. Shevet Achim Gam Yachad. Hinei, hinei, ma tov, ma tov, uma, uma, na'im, na'im. Shevet Achim, Shevet Achim Gam Yachad. Hinei, hinei, ma tov, ma tov, uma, uma, na'im.